that's what makes you what you are, isn't it?
True. I came from a very communal family. People who were more... Let me see something here. Excuse me a minute.
Yeah, that's better.
Mm-hmm.
You're looking younger.
Well, I'm on a program right now, fasting, purifying, and my wife is my coach. So I've been working very hard. When I do webinars, it's usually about 2 or 3 months of research, which plops me down and I don't eat right. And so I'm back on my program to get back to myself. So part of that is weight loss. And I'm going to be taking a step back in age. I'm in my 70s now, so my wife and I, so we're kind of reversing the age process at this time.
You're looking well. I'm in my 60s now.
Yeah, thanks. Oh, you don't look it.
No, because I learned a lot from you guys. You see, I'm a robber.
Well, let's say black don't black.
Yeah. Well, let's say knowledge helps.
Yes.
Doesn't it?
It does.
Yeah.
And very, very happy about that myself. Let me take up your... Good.
Well, your contribution to our... I mean, I've learned a lot from you. As I said, I've been watching your videos for several decades. Yourself, Bobby, Hemet, C. Freeman L., all of them. I've watched all of them.
So, yeah, but C. Freeman L. was one of my big brothers.
Yeah.
That helped me along the path, and we're very happy about what he did to open up that door, because he was one of the first people who helped me to, I guess, step into that world of metaphysics, and from a black perspective.
Yeah.
You know, because most of what we see in metaphysics today is based upon how white people have taken, and I'm not, you know, there's no castigation here.
Yeah.
But a lot of Europeans have taken our culture and they've created this fantasizing component that places them and their blonde here in Africa.
Yep.
And in places that, you know, by all, you know, sensibilities would never be.
No.
So what you see them doing is constructing their own mythos. Yep. From what we left of the information, or what they stole of the information. So I went to study from them, and I always had a caveat in my study, is that where did this information originate from? And when I did do the the back check, it always came back from either Africa or early America.
I felt a lot of it from my mother anyway.
Yes. Yeah, the mothers were the griots. My mother was the griot of our family.
Right. Yeah. My mother came from the Maroon tribe.
Ah, she was from Maroon.
Yeah.
We came, my mother was talking about us coming, you know, well, the French came in after the revolution, and they settled in Trinidad. And a lot of them intermarried with the native people there. And we mixed in with the French and the Spanish. And I know that my mother, we go back to the Fulani. And my mother, my great-grandmother, you had an old picture of her. She had hair down. She was sitting on her hair.
Wow.
And she was very dark and beautiful, but sitting on her hair. But she was kind of mixed in with Indian. My grandfather is Dravidian.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you could see that in his face. And so it was a mixture.
Yeah.
And my grandmother was Portuguese. So they intermarried there. And I mean, it's, you know, in Trinidad and the West Indies, there's a kind of a melding of cultures and racial types.
Yeah.
So I'm mixed in with a lot of that.
Yeah.
You know?
They've basically used that. What I wanted to say is that it seems like, as you say, these people have taken this culture and tried to make it theirs, but it seems like it's turned back on them now.
Yeah, you're right.
It's time to reverse on them now.
Indeed. And a lot of them are coming forward with the confessions.
Yep.
You see, and I like those who come with confessions. They and I can talk. Like the conditions that are happening today in the world and what you're seeing happening today in the world, especially coming from the Middle East.
Yeah.
We're not supposed to talk about that. You know, we would get cut down. It comes back to the saying that you know who rules you by who you cannot criticize.
Yeah.
You see, and so my webinar is going to be dedicated on pulling the skirts and opening the curtain and looking at the wizard behind it. This entire thing is exposing who rules the planet at this time.
Yeah.
And why they're coming out with such bold, ostentatious moves to enslave the rest of the world's population.
Yeah.
And using technology to do it.
Mm. There's military everywhere now. We have military. Oh. We have military here in England. I've been in the fashion business since the 70s, music business since the 70s. My uncle's a music writer. We're going to speak about those things afterwards, but just because you don't know me, but I know you, so it's a little bit unbalanced, but let's just give you a little idea. You know, my uncle was one of the first to have a studio here from the West Indies in England.
Wow.
So, yeah. But we have military here. We have military. I think you have military out in the States, too. I'm pretty sure that there's a lot of military watching everything. All those guys think they're robbing stores and getting away with things and doing all this. They're not getting away with it.
No, they're not.
They're being watched.
Well, you know what? Not only that, they are being allowed to do it in order to set the stage, the preemptive stage for chaos. And you have to understand that when you condition people for chaos, they expect it. It's called preemptive consent.
You have to think, though, that I'm sitting here, a man from England, knowing your things. Those guys who are in the military now, they know what you thought also a long time ago. They prepared for those things that you were talking about. They're not going to allow it to get that chaotic.
They're not going to allow that. But you have to understand, it's called the Hegelian dialectic.
Yeah.
Problem, reaction, solution. Those who are in charge and want to make sure they gain more control over you will create conditions of chaos. And they will say to the people, you have chaos.
Yeah.
What shall we do? And the people say, well, help us. We'll do something about it. And then they are now moving in with the plans that they had when they created the chaos in order to be the solution. And the solution is ever more taking more of your rights away from you.
Yeah. They've tried it, but I don't think it works. I mean, the thing is, like I said, people like yourself have already put it out there. Everybody, I know that, what you said, that they're going to do. So that's destroyed their plan. It's over.
That's the thing. You have these countermeasures. There are people who are not as, I guess, knowledgeable as we are, if you want to say that.
Yeah.
And they essentially are just going along their work, their day shifts, come home, sit down and look at the telly.
Mm-hmm.
And this is all they do. And they pretty much take their instructions directly from whoever it is that's telling us the news that time.
Yeah.
But the problem is, as they're saying, the problem is now young black men and young black women, because they're becoming more and more conscious.
Yeah.
And they can't be railed in by any narratives anymore, because they were created to become individuals by themselves, to think for themselves, except those who went through the colleges and the feminized colleges. And there's this battle between them right now.
Yeah.
And the ones who see the horizon rather than in front of their nose, those are the ones that's going to take over later on. And that's the ones we want to target, the ones who have lifted their eyes off of the immediate situation and condition and are looking at what's really to come on that horizon.
Yeah.
And we are preparing the young people for that. And this webinar will be, I would say, anywhere between 8 and 11 hours long.
Mm.
Because that much information and more that I can't, it would take me 2 days for me to do the type of information necessary to prepare for what's to come in the next 10 years. So I had to kind of condense it as much as possible and hope that people will take up the gauntlet after I've done that.
I'm sure they will. As I said, I think you've done a very good job. But I've watched your lectures 8 hours long.
Yes.
I've watched right through. Indeed.
Yeah.
20 years ago. 10, 20 years ago.
Yeah. Yeah. You're conditioned for that. You see,
yeah.
Yeah. But a lot of people kind of blank out after two or 3 hours, maybe, because they haven't been conditioned to do what we did when we were young. Focus. We used to read. There was no internet. There was none of this phones and stuff. You had to read a book. You had to research. And we conditioned ourselves for that.
Focus.
Mm-hmm. And attention.
Yeah. Focus.
It's very important. Very important, because a lot of people could be focused on the wrong thing.
Yeah.
But when you get the attention necessary, your focus changes.
Yeah.
So attention is very, very important, which is why the observer within us, the part that you and I are speaking to right now, not the flesh, but the part that understands and overstands, that part has been suppressed in the education system, but has been, fooled and manipulated. And the observer now no longer is discerning and put up the necessary sensor and filter to the nonsense that's coming in. So the censoring mechanism, which is our observer, has been co-opted. And so what I'm doing is resuscitating the observer within everyone as much as possible.
Yeah. They do that ritually also when they take this Epstein list is coming out about all these rituals that they're doing and all this. It's going to come out gradually. It's already now Bill Clinton's going to be blown up.
Yeah, the elite watch themselves, and I came from that. I joined in on the as a Mason. I was a Mason.
You were speaking about that years ago.
Yeah. Yes. And was offered a honorary 32nd.
Yeah.
And when I went into the lodge, nobody knew who I was until after I left, and then they started begging me to come back to teach.
Yeah.
And I said, no, I said, I do not see the attention to the kind of information that you espouse a man needs to be and must be at this time, because there's too much partying, too much this, and too much ritualizing rather than intellectualizing and to actually doing the kind of work in the community. I said, here, you've been here for the longest in this community, and I don't see any changes.
Yeah, that's a bad sign. That's a bad sign, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. So I said, no, I do well on my own. I hear from them now and then how they're doing. They're very, they reach out to their brothers, which I commend that.
Mm.
But what they reach them out for at this particular time, I saw a post from the guy who introduced me and raised me in it. And I saw a post before he passed away saying that the worshipful master was very upset at the fact that he was not told who I was.
Oh.
Because, yeah, he was given some tapes by my friend of me. And he called my friend and woke him up at 2:30 in the morning and said, screaming at him, why didn't you tell me who he was? We would have given him a this and a that. And he said, he asked me not to say who he was.
Mm.
Because he wanted to look and see. And I told him, I said, don't tell anybody anything. I just want to come in. And went through the entire ritual. I can't speak on it at this time because it would not honor them.
Mm-hmm.
But I went through everything and was raised. And in that raising, I found out that when they get behind the curtain and the facade and all of the pomp and circumstance, they're just guys who have a little bit more information in the club, at least the one I was in.
Mm.
It was one of the oldest lodges. I think Trump is part of that lodge.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we have guys like Churchill, who were also part of the lodge here in London. I mean, basically the guy was a drunken criminal. He basically needed money. He was broke.
Yes.
They put that out there in the public that he was this war hero. It was so far. If you really look into his history, it was very far from that. The reality of these Masons is very far from what they put out.
Well, you see, what's happened is the Masons that were really wanting to go in to do the work, they're no longer in charge. Who are in charge of who you call the P2 Masons?
Yeah.
Out of Vatican.
Yeah.
Italy. And those are the ones that's running right
Italy.
Now. Masons. Yes, they're coming out of London, England, Buckingham,
yeah.
Out of Vatican and France. These are the P2 Masons who essentially co-opted Masonry, because Masonry went up against the Catholic Church.
Right.
That's what the original was. And they were going up against the Catholic Church and the brutality and the inquisitional type of thing that was going on there. They wanted to bring in what they call the Oriental knowledge, which was the knowledge from the East, in order for them to go beyond religion, in other words, to live a pious life from that perspective. So what happened was the Catholic Church, first of all, invited de Moray, who was the head of Knights Templars at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And the king, I think it was either King Philip.
King Philip it was King Philip.
And yeah, invited him in, and they executed Moray.
Yeah.
Took over that, just the way that the Vatican actually created the Illuminati through Cardinal Ricci.
Mm.
Cardinal Ricci got in touch with the man that supposedly is the head of the Illuminati at that time, created the Illuminati. He was a Jew that converted into Catholicism.
Yeah. And German, so, German Jew.
Yes.
Yeah, he was a German Jew, yeah.
German
Jew. I think it's Weishaupt or something.
Adam Weishaupt.
Adam Weishaupt, yeah.
Mm-hmm, very good. And so that's how it began. The Illuminati was actually who we were in ancient Kemet.
Yeah.
But they took that over, and that became the bulwark against Masonry, who wanted to free themselves from the monarchies. You see. And so that became, when Masonry became Illuminized, that's when it became co-opted.
Right.
You see.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And it was also basically to make sure that we didn't ever
come back to knowledge.
Yeah, because they held the knowledge. And
yeah.
We were the big threat, because if we got it back, that would be worse than the Illuminati.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's why. That's why you saw. That's why you put the Hollywood, put Sigourney Weaver, the palest woman on the planet, as the mother of Ramses. I mean, can you believe that?
Right.
That's the nonsense that's out there. It's becoming comical now, where you see children, cultural children, children who are culturally infantile, wearing the clothes of their parents, if you look at it.
Yeah.
You see it that way. And of course, now they're angry that Hannibal would be played by Denzel Washington,
yeah, that's right.
Yeah, but see, I'm a little bit concerned on that, because the Hannibal that conquered Rome was only 22 years of age.
Yeah.
You see, and Denzel is in his 60s.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well, maybe after he's running away, and because, you know, he committed suicide so that they wouldn't get to him.
Mm.
Yeah, and so I'd like to see a younger person play Hannibal, you know, and do all he did. Because Hannibal was such a great general at his young age, because Barca, his father, actually taught him everything. And the beautiful part about it was that he essentially gathered together the first army that was constituted of different types of weaponry and assault. So he had cavalrymen, archers. And they didn't know what to do with him.
Elephants.
This man was...
He was a crazy man.
He studied in Annapolis. He studied in all around the world. They studied Hannibal.
Yeah, Schwarzkopf and all these guys, they all follow his military. U.S. military watches stuff. They look at his stuff still.
Erwin Rommel, the German general.
Yeah, the German.
He had a picture of Hannibal.
Of course.
Yes.
Who else? Like, Picasso has African art around him.
Oh, big time.
Yeah.
They didn't know that was his inspiration.
Right. They thought he was just some show business going on in the background.
And it was the same thing with Freud.
Yeah.
Not Freud. Freud. And Freud himself.
Freud.
And who's the one who deals with, he dealt with evolution? Darwin.
Yeah.
You know where the evolution and theory came from? Darwin's father was an Egyptologist, and he collected all of the statuary that had heads of you know, the heads of the lion with right. the body of the man, and that's where that idea came from.
Crazy. Yeah, I think I read that too. Yeah, he had relatives who were all involved in, I think, a cousin or something, and
oh yes.
He was another Freemason. He's another Hidden Hand guy.
All of them are raised. Yeah, that's why they have to shut down.
Yeah, they're not allowed to say too much, are they?
Well, see, that's what I teach in my school. I don't teach what they do in the ritualism in Masonry.
Yeah.
But what they wanted me to teach was the metaphysics.
Right.
That's what we teach at our university. And this is what I'm going to incorporate in the webinar.
How is your university doing? You've had it for a very long time now.
Yeah, my university started back in 1985 when I was in New York. And we would do it in the outdoors, and we had a little center where we would speak to a lot of young people who were curious at that time. But 17 years ago, when we moved to Florida from New York, we had no way to reach out to our people, so I went investigating on what to do to reach the people that I had, my former students. And I came upon a technology that the CEOs of great companies were using to contact a lot of their, the smaller parts of their company.
Yeah.
They get in contact with them. They had this technology that the CEOs would use. I said, well, what is that? I checked it out, and we turned that technology into the first university online. Mm-hmm. We were first to put a university online. Mm-hmm. And they're now charging the same amount we charge every month when we do our university. So when we did that, it took it to a whole other stage.
Yeah.
At that point, I was able to reach people all over the world. I mean, I had China, Japan, and Kenya, South Africa, Zimbabwe, down there in down under
Australia.
Australia, yeah. Yes. All over, and up in Europe too, Sweden. I was reaching out there. I mean, I didn't know there were so many black folks all over this world that were interested in it, you see?
Of course.
Which was beautiful.
Of course. What about I'm going to go in so many different areas because I know you're used to that. what about the music business? I mean, I've interviewed some guys which you probably know, like who passed away. Sam Rivers, Yusuf Lateef, all these guys. I've interviewed all these guys. Ahmad Jamal.
You had the masters.
Yeah, the real masters.
Want to sell a Toyota? Get the music. If you want to sell Listerine, get the music. In fact, I made a Listerine commercial years ago. If you want to sell this, get the music. Now, I don't agree with all the music. That's why I'm so happy I have a mute button. Without that mute button, forget about it.
You throw the TV out, wouldn't you?
Please. Mm. It's an insult.
Mm. Yeah.
They could have the same sales results by putting music on instead of some of the stuff that they are pitching on these commercials. I mean, it's the decibels are way up there.
Yeah.
It's an insult to your intelligence, some of the stuff that's put on commercials, really. Mm-hmm. So I hope it's obvious, but I don't know, Mr. McLean, if it's obvious or not.
It could be too late anyway.
Because, you know, they can rock, they can sway the public any way they want. I'm sorry, that's the way it is.
Yeah.
They can take this stuff and brainwash you.
Yeah. And make it work good for them.
It's obvious to you, obvious to me, hopefully. To the discerning group, but everyone doesn't go for it. Some people don't use that mute button.
They just
let it ride. Until they're crawling up the wall somewhere.
Yeah. Wriggling in pain, huh?
Mm-hmm.
I've interviewed also Chuck D and these younger, my generation, too.
Professor Griff. In Manhattan, yeah.
Professor Griff, I know you dealt with Professor Griff.
Professor Griff was one of my closest brothers. His name is Black Dot, they call him.
Yeah, I know.
Remember Black Dot? And Black Dot, we was getting married, and Professor Griff was one of the best men at the wedding.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, they had the wedding on YouTube.
Wow.
Yeah, it was beautiful. I married about 200-300 people.
Really?
Yeah, and they only maybe one or two actually broke up.
That shows the energy. The right energy was right.
When I do it, no. When I do a ritual marriage,
yeah,
it's carnival.
Right, right.
It's beautiful. And what happened is a lot of people. The one I did was in Central Park, and it was for these sisters, sisters of the Calabash, they called them.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful sisters, and they were very famous around the world because they traveled and they did their African dance and they played their instruments. And this one had, she was brought out with these brothers, I mean, muscular brothers.
Yeah.
They carried her out like queen. It was fantastic. And the brother came out, and the brothers were warriors.
Yeah.
And the brother who was back, man, he was coming. He almost looked like he was floating coming out.
Wow.
And the brothers were there with their spears, and it was, oh, incredible. Yeah. And she came out, and they laid her down, what do you call it? Mm-hmm. And the funny part about it is beautiful. The woman that they carried out,
mm-hmm,
came to, and it was like, it was a ritual, and it came, and she was getting ready to get down on the knee in front of me,
mm-hmm,
and then this woman came out and grabbed her and pulled her, and it pulled the mask because she was veiled. They pulled the veil off. It wasn't the bride. So they said, oh, so there's a ritual where they make sure, because a woman can be sneaking in there to get married.
Wow.
And so it was so interesting. Then the bride really came in, and they had her. It was so beautiful. I mean, it was really beautiful.
You must have made double your money that day.
Oh, man. Well, no, I don't charge much when I went back in the days when I did the weddings.
That's the reason to get double your money. If you don't charge a lot in the first place.
Oh, they put me in the, there's a book out called Jumping the Broom. My ritual.
I remember that from The Roots. They jumped the broom in The Roots.
Right. But there was a book out called Jumping the Broom, all the different rituals. That we as melanated people do, and my show made it in there.
Wow. I'm going to pull the pictures together afterwards, and I want to go through some of the music that influenced you from the early days, because I like to put the album covers there and stuff.
Yeah.
It won't be just me and you talking, there'll be album covers flicking by for people to go back and look at.
Yeah, as far as when I did music back in the day, I don't have anything. Because we were pretty much scuttled.
Mm.
We were poorly managed. That's number one.
Mm.
Rodney Dangerfield, you know him as a comedian.
Yeah.
His manager wanted us.
Mm.
We had Peter Lane that was supposed to be getting the Commodores.
Mm.
Bernie Ashburn. He was supposed to manage us. And we had a couple of things. But Peter Lane really messed with us.
Mm.
Peter Lane was our lawyer that we had given him our tapes. And he went to Electra Asylum. I don't want to say anything more, but he went to actually Epic.
Mm.
And when he went to Epic, the song, we wrote a song for Jimi Hendrix.
Wow.
Not Jimi Hendrix, Eddie Kendricks.
Eddie Kendricks, yeah.
I like Jimi Hendrix.
Singer.
Yeah, but Eddie Kendricks was looking for song materials.
Yeah.
We got the word on the grapevine. So we wrote a song called Dr. Rock for him.
Mm-hmm.
And the bass line was actually stolen. We found out from Quincy Jones that this person likes to steal.
Mm-hmm.
And he reversed the bass line,
right,
that we gave for Dr. Rock. Mm-hmm. And when we heard that, that broke up my group.
Yeah.
Because that was the last straw. We had gone through so much. My bass player left and went... with Chaka Khan.
Mm-hmm.
Our drummer went with Cameo.
Oh.
And he was a backup drummer when to deal with. So we broke up. Keyboard player went with Sesame Street.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was a big gig at that point.
That's big. That was but, big.
Yeah. And the funny thing about it is, I don't think I was meant to do that because I met everyone. You can see, if you go to my email, you'll see me with Verdeen White.
And from Earth, Wind & Fire.
Yeah, Earth, Wind & Fire, because we're very, very close with Earth, Wind.
Yeah.
Members in there. I was the, son? Philip's son is my student.
Philip
and
White.
The drummer who passed, he was my student. And we were very close. I mean, I was very heavy into music. We opened up for James Brown. Wow. We were mostly into the Delphonics and these people like that. And so that was a turn right now. I found out that a lot of young people from your generation, when we doing the hip hop, I didn't know that my song that I wrote called You Have Everything That a Man Could Love, mm-hmm. which is now on YouTube, the bass line that I created was used by, what's his name, the rapper who turned his name is Azeem. I think he turned his name into Azeem. Yeah. Most Def, his name.
Most Def.
Yeah. Mm. Most Def and Jay Electronica wrote a song, mm-hmm. and my bass line. Mm-hmm. And I found out from a lot of the people on YouTube, there's about 5 or 6 well-known rappers that use the bass line as, mm-hmm. as part of their, what do you call it? And I was saying, well, at least it did get out there, you know, after a while, you know. But I had a lot of trauma in the music business. And it was telling me while I was studying metaphysics on the road that somehow when the disappointments happened based on my mental, what I was doing, it didn't hit me as hard as it hit the group. And when it hit the group hard, it hit me hard.
Right.
And I needed to, I didn't want to empathize because I knew that there was something greater. But to them, it was everything. And that hurt me.
The music business can be a very nasty business. I mean, Piddly or P. Diddy's coming up now for, you know, he's really going to be shown off. So.
Well, I outed him maybe, 8, 9 years ago, 10 years ago?
I know.
More than that.
A long time ago.
I was in New York in the 90s, yeah.
I remember you did a lecture about hip-hop. It was brilliant. It was you pretty much the things you said then are pretty much happening now. It's like, I can only laugh about it because it's, because it's so long ago, you know.
I hate that. You know, the only thing that I don't like about being ahead of the curve is being right. I want to be wrong so many times because I'm hoping that someone sees what it is that I've put out there for them. And do something to avert that.
Yeah, but the hip hop thing at that time was already right, and now it's just got worse. It's even worse, right?
I predicted it would happen, and it did happen.
Yeah.
Especially when they had that meeting in California, when they were actually creating these supermax prisons, that they wanted to fill those prisons with people, and so what used to be a kind of a jovial hip hop. Guys battling one another turned into this
bestiality.
Yeah, criminal organization. Yeah. I mean, if you look today at young people when they go back and study their own stars from rap, not hip hop, but rap, I call it.
Yeah.
Because it was a rap after that. And what happened was you don't hear them speaking about music like our people did. Like, you don't see Earth, Wind & Fire sitting down and talking about who shot who. And, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, who was scared of who. No, oh, no. You know, big
dude. Who had the shoulders. Who had big shoulders. Who didn't.
Chest pumping and all of that. What about the music?
Yeah.
These people sitting around in barber chairs talking about who scared who shot who. Who was more intimidating than who.
I've had musicians approaching me in interviews, guys that are well known, you know, not the younger generation. I'm like, look, I'm 40 odd years old. I didn't come here for this.
Right. But you know, you hope they listen.
Yeah, of course. That's why I'm telling them that, because hey, that's going to get silly. There's 4 of you and there's 1 of me.
That's right. Well, if we do our work, we just have to convince 1/10 the population. We just have to convince 1/10 of that population, and we will definitely be a change in the world.
I agree with that. I think we're well on the way, though. As I said, you've done. I mean, how many decades have you been putting out information? That must be about 40 years now.
40 years.
There you go.
You have to excuse me. Like I said, I'm doing my cleansing and purification.
I've got the flu.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Just deal with your rest.
Yeah, sleep a lot. You have to sleep.
Sleep. The body will take care of everything.
Yeah. Yeah. No pills, no drugs, no
necessary.
No cocaine, no crack, nothing.
No, you put those aside to do the healing.
To heal, you put them aside. So, what about the musicians that influenced you to go into music? Who were those people that you thought were important?
I was a very high tenor. You'd hear in that music if you listen to You Have Everything by the Metaphors. Mm. That was the name of my group. And it turned into Juggernaut later on when we went rock. Mm. But groovers who used to come to practice with us made it into it. Living Color was one of our friends from back in the day. But the ones that influenced me were the tenors. Smokey Robinson was one of my biggest influences because I used to sing at talent shows. And so I had his voice down pat.
He was amazing anyway in his time.
Still amazing.
Yeah, he's still amazing.
His voice texture was, he had a high tenor and I had a high tenor. But when I was, the song You Have Everything was actually cut when I was like 19 years old. So my voice register was way up there. Mm. Matter of fact, one of the background singers from Chaka Khan, we were contesting to see who would get a higher note. Mm. And I matched her up to the high C's. Wow. So that's the way I was. And so Smokey Robinson, Pookie from the Delphonics. Mm-hmm.
What about Curtis Mayfield, all these guys? I mean, he was...
Musically, yes, but my vocal, these were the vocalists are the ones that get Russell from the Stylistics back in the day.
Oh, yeah.
Musically, James Brown, Earth, Wind & Fire, War, Fat City Strut, what's the name of that group again? Came out of Brooklyn. They were doctors. Somebody would know. It'll probably come to me a little bit.
Isley Brothers.
Isley Brothers. They found our tape in their garbage can. Yeah, they were listening to our tape. And one of the musicians who was invited to one of the sessions was looking through the garbage. And they were looking at different tapes. And they saw Metaphor. Mm. Wow. So we knew we were influencing a lot of the music. We came in. And I don't know if you ever heard of Sid Bernstein. Sid Bernstein brought the Beatles over. Yeah, he brought the Beatles over.
Oh, yeah. Then I met him. I think I met him in London.
Yeah. Sid Bernstein wanted to manage us because we were doing some serious rock and they wanted us to manage us. But we had cut a deal with a previous manager that screwed us something fierce.
Yeah.
And so Rodney Dangerfield's manager... what was his name again? It'll probably come to me again. But Rodney Dangerfield's manager said that he wanted a rock group.
Yeah.
And his boy came after he saw one of the gigs. His friend saw a gig with us and told him. And he flew all the way from Las Vegas to see it. Mm-hmm. Loved what we did. And we were supposed to go and meet... because these guys are cold mafia.
Yeah.
And we were supposed to go and meet them. And they gave us the offer. We got half of our publishing. Mm-hmm. And we can keep half the publishing. Well, they'll deal with the fronting all of the thing. They'll get us the opening acts for big stars and all that. Mm-hmm. Scuttled it. Yeah. Scuttled the whole thing because we had already offered her... the 50%, because we didn't know what we were doing at that time. We were young.
Right.
And we offered her the 50% for the publishing. And we asked her, well, can you give us 25 cents back? Because this will take not you, not us, but you too. Mm. You know, you can come along with us. Mm. No. They didn't go for it. Mm. So that stymied us. We were excellent. Imagine to sit there where the Commodores were in their office, and they were considering managing us. That's how good we were.
Commodores were huge.
Yeah.
Lionel Richie still has a career.
Well, Benny Ashburn was the sweetest dude. He was their manager. Mm. And so you guys have a band, huh? And we were like, oh my God. We're sitting before Benny Ashburn, the Commodores. This guy came out of Motown. This was the Motown legend, you know?
Right.
And so you got Ben, huh? I said, yeah. He says, you got the tape? And I said, yeah. We gave him the tape. And again, the offer came. We had to turn it down because We were even stymied. And this other person wasn't giving us anything that we could actually use to step us forward, just the Chitlin circuit. So that was our experience there in music. Got to meet a lot of people in the music business, partied with them, knew them, Larry Graham.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's Sly.
What about the ones you grew up with? What about in your childhood? Who did you grow up listening to?
I grew up in the church, Catholic church.
Yeah.
I was in the choir. And, you know, I learned music then, and appreciation for music. But listen, you know where I was in Trinidad. Mm. Where I lived in Jerningham Avenue. Next door to me was where they made the steel pan.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So I would listen to music all day.
Right.
We'd be coming from there. And then when we went to Carnival, I didn't hear music.
Yeah.
And so I had, because of my ability to write, I had my book, The Wounded Womb,
and
I wrote a number of other materials. I wrote all the songs for my group. And so I had a way with that, listening to Smokey Robinson and the way he would put together an iambic pentameter, the way he would phrase, to use words. And so I learned all of that from just listening.
Yeah.
And when I came up, the first group I met was with my first wife, Charlene. We lived in the very same projects that Jay-Z, she lived there.
Mm-hmm.
Jay-Z came out of Brooklyn,
mm-hmm.
in the Marcy projects. And we used to sing a cappella out on the park.
Yeah.
And gather, people would gather around us.
Just like the Lost Poets.
Yes, indeed. So we would bring people around us, we would sing. And really harmonize on the subway, because you get that resonating from the subways. You call it the underground.
Underground.
Right, and there's this echo in there, beautiful sound.
That's right.
And we used to get people to come give us money, and, well, really? Were that good? Yeah.
Mm.
So the people that came together to sing, there was this beautiful competition with all these groups that didn't have any kind of rapping going on. The only rapping that we knew was a guy his name is Imhotep Gary Bird.
He was big.
Yeah, he did his,
I remember The Crown.
Right, The Crown. That's what he was the first one doing that all that
about,
rap.
That's about 81, 82, something like that.
Yeah. Definitely.
Yeah.
And so we had a good time when I was with my youth and I met my first wife. She's the mother of my two children, and we had a great, great run, and I met a lot of people who inspired me musically. Again, like I said, Smokey Robinson, Pookie Hart from the Delphonics, the Main Ingredient, all of the real singers of the singing groups, the Dells, all of these real great singers were my vocal inspiration, music inspiration. Was Sly and the Family Stone, Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Mm.
And so I did a mixture of that, singing with the voices.
Yeah.
You know, with Earth, Wind, and Fire, the harmonies, love them.
And they were spiritually inclined as well. I remember you discussing Earth, Wind, and Fire. They were studying metaphysics, some of those guys.
Yes. Well, that's where I met, what's wrong with you today, Phil? Maurice White.
Yeah.
Maurice used to come, when he got into New York, he used to come to a place called, it was sitting on the corner of Lexington Avenue and 125th Street, and it was called the Tree of Life.
Mm-hmm. I remember you said,
And the Tree of Life was situated right there in the middle of Harlem, and they had all these esoteric books. So one of my first mentors in metaphysics as well was Brother Kanya Kakumba.
Mm.
That's where I met, you know, Youssef. I met Dr. John Clark.
Mm.
And that's where I met Stravinskis, the guy who wrote the book. I forgot the name of the book, but he wrote an incredible book on sprouting and natural. So when that's where I met Maurice there. And we struck up a conversation in metaphysics.
Yeah.
Very short one, because, you know, his people were always around him. And from that point forward, I went to all their shows and loved them whenever they were in New York.
They were amazing. I'm Up in the Fire.
Oh, listen, those backstage.
Here in England, they're huge. They were huge here.
Oh, listen, backstage you have to see how the game went, because they had a spaceship. They had a spaceship on the stage, right? And I'm backstage, and they having on these uniforms, and they're playing, they're building up. Yeah. One of them are leaving, and I think it was the drummer who said, "Shh," yeah, to me. Yeah. And then I said, "Reese," because that's how you call him, Maurice. Mm. "What's going on?" He said, "You need to be out front." Mm. This. And Verdeen was like, you know, all excited and stuff. So when it came out, everybody was leaving, and there was this music that was going on, and there was this spaceship that you would see that they would come out from the spaceship inside, and then they would walk up the stairs, and they would then wave to the audience, these Martians. And then all of a sudden you're saying, okay, well, they're walking in there. And these Martians are coming out, and before you knew it, they learned it from the magician from out of Las Vegas. I forgot his name. This great magician sold them this particular
idea,
and it went so crazy, and the audience went nuts.
Oh, yeah.
When they took off the hat, and he thought the aliens were different from them because they walked into their spaceship.
Yeah.
And you saw these aliens kind of drifting around, and before you knew it, they pulled it off. It was them. Damn. And the audience went crazy.
Yeah.
It was beautiful. And then we partied afterwards.
Good times.
Oh, man, back in the day.
Yeah.
No, nothing like them. And I really lament for the young people today. They don't party with that kind of joyful abandon anymore.
No.
It's always about life and death.
Yeah, there's always some other technology that gets involved, you know. My phone's ringing.
and this is it. You can't even fellowship with one another anymore.
Oh, it's impossible. I'm really glad that I didn't grow up in this mess.
Me too.
Yeah.
You know, I grew up around Bush.
Yeah.
Back in the Bush.
Yeah.
And I recommend that for all young people. They need to be in the sand, in the dirt. They need to be in the bush.
Yeah, feet, you know? No socks on, no shoes, in the mud.
I was very, 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 very recalcitrant to wear shoes.
Yeah.
And when I came back from Trinidad, you know, I mean, we live by the ocean.
Mm-hmm.
So I bathed every day in the ocean. I drowned in the ocean. In fact, I died in the ocean.
I remember you said, yes.
I brought it back. And that whole thing with snakes, you know, we were right around away from swamp, gators. Mm. You had to live in that kind of environment to appreciate God.
Yeah, but with gators around, I think you'd appreciate God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I nursed a little squirrel. We found a squirrel there, and I remember nursing it into Larian, and it would, as it grew, it would come and stand on the on the hut where we lived. We lived in a very small wooded house, and it would jump there, and I'd see his tail, like, you know, tell me to come, and we'd give him a little food.
Mm-hmm.
My grandmother was the doula.
Yeah. Oh.
She was the
That's the health lady.
Oh yeah, but, you know, it's funny because the whole place was like a African village.
Yeah.
And women who were pregnant, they would be birthing a baby on my grandmother's table, and then the next thing, dinner was being served there, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That type of thing.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
So my grandfather also had a copra farm. He would dry out the coconuts and then sell them for the oil back in the day. We had about 300 acres that were stolen from us down there.
Do you think you'll ever get that back?
I thought about it because I'm looking at the future, and we're in the XRP, we're into cryptocurrency is very strong. I'm into the cash flow situation. So my revengeful heart wants to go back there and just buy that property and, you know,
yeah,
and they tear down everything that they put up in there. Because they found oil.
Yeah, okay.
You see?
It's a little bit like that movie. Have you seen this new movie? I think it's called Killing of the Flower Moon. It's about the so-called Native Americans, which probably was us, us.
Right.
They were killing off the natives to get their property.
Right.
It's an incredible story with by Martin Scorsese. These guys are poisoning they're literally poisoning their wives.
Wow.
It's wild.
Well, see, that's what happened
it's
when we
wild.
Took the land. That's what happened when we put the land in charge with the women.
Yeah.
Because in African tradition, the land essentially was passed through the mother.
Yeah.
But the tools to work the land was passed through the father. That's how you kept the balance.
Right.
You see?
Right.
So what the white man did was marry the women and took the land.
Yeah, that's what they did. Yeah.
Yeah.
And poison, and was poison. These guys, this film, you've got to see it, because there's a scene where they go into the Freemasons' hall and everything.
What?
Just showing you that they're Freemasons.
Oh, man.
It's like, I was like, no, you couldn't tell me that.
Oh, wow.
Martin Scorsese made this movie, and it was Robert De Niro was the, that was one demon. That's one hell of a demon there.
Really?
Yeah.
And I mean, he married black women.
Oh yeah, but in this movie, also in this movie, he got them to marry. He got the guys around him to marry these women, and he took everybody out. He was taking everybody out. He was poisoning people. He was doing all having people shot up. It's a true story.
Of course, there's true stories.
It's a true story.
The white man is now coming out to speak about his sins. You know,
he's coming out to speak about their sins.
They're telling you what their new sins are going to be. You see, and they have to do that because they understand karma.
Yeah.
So they have to come out and tell you what they're going to do.
I know.
Which is why a lot of people can't decipher what they're going to ready to do. This is what my webinar is about. That's how you stay ahead.
Yeah. But I don't think they're going to be able to do anything once you put it out there like you always do.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the sword's already been blunted.
Mm-hmm.
So you put it out again.
Yeah,
It's a mess for them. It doesn't. Yeah. It's not going to work.
Well, you know, learning and teaching is a process.
Oh, it's important. Yeah,
It's not an event. It's a process.
Yeah, of course.
So everybody has to mature, and they only mature at their own pace.
Of course. I'm not saying you shouldn't put it out there. Of course, you have to do that. You have to put the information out.
You're good. You know why? Because you put it out there raw.
Yeah.
And you see, young people, we have to get them to catch up. We don't have to catch up to them. They have to catch up to us.
Yeah.
And the older they get, the smarter they get.
Yeah.
They look for something different than what they're doing.
Yeah.
And so I learned that myself, that you can't feed them now. They say, you know, you can feed a man a fish now or teach him how to fish.
Yeah.
And the only way that I knew how to pass on the information so that it became something that stayed prominent and now. My stuff from 40 years ago is prominent today.
Yeah, I know.